Good evening.
Good evening, Father.
So, when we began this series in January, it's dark outside, right?
Yes.
And the light is growing stronger. So hopefully that's true in our hearts as well. I want to try out the story that I think I'm going to use in my homily this coming weekend, so it's kind of a preview. So, early in March, Father Jim and I, this was his birthday gift to me. My birthday was February 28th, as you know, and I was here with you on February 28th. So, I love the symphony orchestra, so to see, so for my birthday, he took me to Cleveland, and we went to the Cleveland Symphony one night. It was an all-American concert, so they had three pieces that night. They did my absolute all-time favorite piece, which is Aaron Copland's Third Symphony. They did a Leonard Bernstein suite from On the Waterfront, and then there was a modern or a contemporary composer piece that none of us knew anything about. And as the Cho was taking us to Severance Hall for a concert, this woman got into the car with us, and we introduced ourselves, and she said, we're on the program tonight. So we told her, Father Jim told her, actually, he said, Copland, Bernstein, and then there's this modern piece, he said, a contemporary composer, don't know her, but you know, I tried to listen to it on YouTube, and it sounded to me like somebody just, you know, gave a classroom of first graders a bunch of instruments and said, bang the shit out of it. That's what it sounded like. Turns out this woman was Augusta Thomas, the composer of the piece that we were going to hear that night. I don't know what I'm going to do with that story, but I love that story. Because it's like, you know who your audience is. He was the composer of the piece. Someone had asked me about chalices, and so I had David go and get this, and I'm going to just, as I speak, pass it around and just tell you a little bit about this. So, when a priest is ordained, typically his family, their gift to him for ordination is a chalice. And so this chalice was given to me by my family 31 years ago when I was ordained, and I've been using it at every Mass for the last 31 years. It is dedicated, actually, I guess you can still read it a little bit, in memory of Thomas Andrews, who is my grandfather, my mother's father, who was a state deputy for the Knights of Columbus back in the 1950s. And then when my grandmother died, my family had the diamonds from her wedding ring placed in a cross in gold on the base of the chalice. And as you can see, in enamel around the cup are the 12 apostles and Jesus. So this is the chalice I have used at Eucharist to celebrate the Eucharist for the last 31 years. And I will use until I go out and toes up. So I'm just going to, you can just pass it around from table to table and look at it if you like. Let me add, I know you've heard these words before many times, all right? At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. When those words of institution are prayed as the central part of the Eucharistic prayer at every Mass, the grace of God floods the bread and wine to change them into the body and blood of Christ for our nourishment. And in that flooding of grace upon those elements, yes, that bread and that wine, substances, become substantially the body and blood of Jesus Christ, the real presence, body, soul, and spirit of Jesus, given for us. But I want you also to take note of the four actions that take place in the Eucharistic institution. So Eucharist is not just substance, which it truly is, that we adore, that we reverence, but it is also action. So what does Jesus do? He takes the bread and the wine. He blesses the bread and the wine. He breaks the bread, pours the wine, and he gives them. Taking, blessing, breaking, pouring, and giving. Those are the four actions of the Eucharist. And those four actions of the Eucharist are also what Jesus does with us. Taking, blessing, breaking, pouring, and giving. Jesus takes each one of us as his own. And from the very beginning of the story of salvation, we know this from the creation. God takes us as his own by creating us in his own image and likeness, and setting us over the whole world in all its wonder to serve him, our creator, and to care for the creation that he has given us. He takes us as his adopted children through the grace of baptism. God takes us as his own. We are baptized into the death and resurrection of Jesus, taken as God's very own. One spiritual writer put it this way: God has adopted billions of children, but he treats each one of us as an only child. That's how precious we are. We are taken as his own. Second, bless. We are blessed, each of us, with an abundance of grace. We are blessed uniquely, each of us, with how God has endowed each of us to be his image and likeness in the world. I look around here, and I know so many of you so very well, and I see that uniqueness. I see that original blessing. Now, we sometimes obscure that blessing, don't we? Or we forget it, you know? But that blessing is there. We are each so abundantly blessed and uniquely blessed by God with special gifts. And here's the hard part. We're taken, blessed, broken, poured out. Bread broken, wine poured. What does it mean to be broken and poor? I don't want to embarrass Marty, And I don't think I will, because she's such a dear, dear, valued, beyond valued friend and fellow minister. But we have a funeral here on Friday of three, it'll be a three-casket funeral. Three women who perished in a house fire. A year ago, a little over a year ago. In Marty's family, several perished in house fires. Now she's ministering to this family. How do you do that? Because you are a wounded healer. That's what I mean by broken and poured out. Your grief, your weakness becomes your strength, out of which you minister to others. That great philosopher of life, Tina Turner, in one of her songs, asks the question, who needs a heart if a heart can be broken? Right? Well, Tina, dumb question. Because anyone who has ever loved another person knows that the whole reason God gave us a heart is so that it can be broken. Not apart in little pieces, but broken open. In order to love and give, right? Broken and poured out. And then given. He took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it. He took the wine, he blessed it, he poured it out, and he gave it to them. So what happens to bread and wine happens to you and me. Taken by God, blessed abundantly by God, broken and poured out, and given to the world to become Jesus, to become what we consume in the Eucharist, to become the real presence of Jesus for the world in the Eucharist. Go back to what we were talking about with sacraments. Remember, ex opere operato, ex opere operantis. Ex opere operato. Does the grace of the Eucharist work in us without our awareness, without our cooperation? Yes. Ex opere operato. By the work worked. God's grace is working in us, whether we know it or not. Whether we accept it or not, whether we cooperate with it or not. It's there. Remember we talked about these sacraments, especially the centrality of the Eucharist, as the privileged moments of God's movement and grace poured into our hearts and into our lives. It's always going to work. Does it work? Yes. And then ex opere operantis is how much more beautiful and fruitful and powerful that grace is with our intentional participation in it, with our response, our cooperation, our mindfulness, ex opere operantis, by the word accepted, so that we're broken and poured out and given to the world. That's the action of the Eucharist. A couple weeks ago, a couple Sundays ago, we had that wonderful story of the woman at the well that meets Jesus. Now, in the scripture, the image, the reality of water is often used as a wonderful symbol of God's grace. God, the outpouring, the flooding of his grace in our lives. That's a wonderful story for that. And what we encounter in that story are a couple things. It's so layered with symbolism, as so many of the gospel stories are. But the first thing we encounter is that Jesus is a breaker of barriers. Remember, Pope Francis said recently, a disciple of Jesus, a Christian, doesn't build walls. He builds bridges. Water, often in so many scripture stories, are used as a symbol of this flooding of God's grace into our lives. And remember, go back again many weeks ago when we talked about how, when we were talking about spirituality, God initiates, we respond. Right? God initiates, we respond. What is our response to that outpouring of God's grace into our lives? So Jesus breaks the barriers with this woman at the well, at least in three different ways that I can see. First of all, Jews had nothing to do with Samaritans. They hated each other. I mean, a Jew would rather take 3 extra days on a journey to go around the whole territory of Samaria to get where he was going than even go through it. They wouldn't even spit on a Samaritan. That's how much enmity there was between the two people. Jesus was aware of that. He knew that. And here he's in Samaria. So he's breaking that barrier. Secondly, a rabbi, which Jesus was, a teacher, in his culture and his time, would never speak in public with a woman. That's the culture of the time. Not even his own wife or daughter would he speak in public with. It would ruin his reputation as a rabbi, as a teacher. So he's speaking with a woman. And thirdly, another barrier he's breaking is not just any woman. This is a notorious woman. How should I put this? This is a woman that you would not want your son to bring home to meet you. There's a reason she's at the well at noon, in the heat of the day, because the people of her own village, the women of her own village, would go to the well in the morning when it was cool, not in the noon of the day. So she can't even be accepted by the women of her own village. She's notorious. And as the story unfolds, we hear why. She's had 5 husbands, and the man she's living with now is not her husband. All right? So he's breaking all of these barriers. That's one level of symbolism going on in that story. But I think the more important one is the whole thing of, I will give you living water if you ask. What is this living water? The outpouring of the very grace of God into her life. And she becomes aware that he is the Holy One, the Messiah, the Christ, and then begins to take the message out. And that's what I want to get to. Because what all of this tells us is that change, conversion, transformation is the central dynamic of a disciple of Jesus. God initiates his outpouring of grace, living water. What is our response? Conversion, transformation, change. To be a disciple of Jesus is to change always, to constantly be converted. And I want to talk now about that conversion process. And I want to begin by using an image that Jesus used often in his own teaching and in his own parables, because he knew his audience. He's preaching to a people who were living in an agrarian culture, close to the earth, growing olives, growing grapes, growing other food. So they're working the earth, and especially the way the Gospel of Mark is set up, I think, helps us with this. So Jesus begins let's start with his model of life. We know Jesus was many things, but he certainly was a man immersed in the culture of his time. Fully human, fully divine, but immersed in the culture of his time using the imagery that would relate to people, to teach them in his parables. Mark's gospel, and all the gospels really, but Mark is the epitome of this. He begins to teach them the basic message, follow God, follow my God. He begins by announcing the kingdom of God is here. And this is who God is. Abba and transcendent one. He begins to reveal to them his relationship with his Father. As he progresses in that gospel, he calls for a choice of his followers. So the key hinge in Mark's gospel, Matthew and Luke as well, but especially you can see it in Mark. The hinge of that gospel is when Jesus says to his disciples, who do people say that I am? Remember that passage? They say, well, some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, some one of the prophets. And then he says, who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? Who do you? And that's a question to each one of us. Who do you say that I am? Peter answers for us. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. So he calls for that choice. Who am I for you? Once you make that commitment, this is who you are for me, then he teaches them about the kingdom of God. What does it mean to be my follower? What does it mean to encounter me in this relationship? He teaches very clearly and in depth what it means to be the Christ, to follow this path of self-sacrificing love that I will live out for you in my death and resurrection. And then he sends them forth to do what I have done for you in my name. So this is the pattern of his own life, the model of his own life, and in the physical image of growth, again, so many times in his parables, he uses this, the parable of the weeds and the wheat, the parable of the sower and the seed, the parable of the fig tree, all of these growth images. Anybody a gardener or a farmer? Plant flowers, vegetables, what do you got to do? Prepare the ground before you sow the seed. The seed's either going to grow or it doesn't. If it grows, you nurture it, you fertilize it. And then what do? You harvest. And then you reseed. It goes back. It's cyclical, right? So this imagery that Jesus uses in his teaching parallels his own life and the way he presents who he is and what he's about. Again, elaborate it a little bit. You begin by building that relationship of trust, right? Belonging leads to believing, leads to behaving. So, without a relationship of trust, none of it is possible. This is who I am. Who are you? You know, you're in that relationship, learning to know each other. You preach the good news that personal experience that you have of your relationship with the Lord Jesus. You know, this is who he is. People have to be left free to choose. I want to be a part of that, or I don't want to be part of that. The seed's either going to grow or it doesn't. If it grows with the yes of the commitment, then it's time for catechesis, what we call catechesis, teaching about the kingdom of God, what it means to be in relationship with Jesus. And then you can be sent forth. Ministry, mission, empowered by Jesus and by God's grace to go forth and to spread the gospel. We call these moments pre-evangelization, evangelization, conversion, catechesis, mission, ministry, sacrament. So it all just parallels in terms of Jesus' own example in his own life. Let me read you this reading from the prophet Ezekiel. This is one of my favorite stories from the Old Testament. The angel brought me, Ezekiel, back to the entrance of the temple of the Lord, and I saw water flowing out from beneath the threshold of the temple toward the east. For the facade of the temple was toward the east. The water flowed down from the right side of the temple south of the altar. He led me outside by the north gate and around to the outer gate facing the east, where I saw the water trickling from the right side. Then, when he had walked off to the east with a measuring cord in his hand, he measured off 1,000 cubits and had me wade through the water, which was ankle deep. He measured off 1,000, and once more he made me wade through the water, which was now knee deep. Again, he measured off 1,000 and had me wade the water up to my waist. Once more, he measured off 1,000. But there was now a river through which I could not wade, for the water had risen so high it had become a river that could not be crossed except by swimming. And he asked me, "Have you seen this, son of man?" Then he brought me back to the bank of the river, where he had me sit. And along the bank of that river, I saw very many trees on both sides. He said to me, "This water flows into the eastern district down upon the Arabah and empties into the sea the salt waters which it makes fresh. Wherever the river flows, every sort of living creature that can multiply shall live, and there shall be abundant fish. For wherever this water comes, the sea shall be made fresh. Along both banks of the river, fruit trees of every kind shall grow. Their leaves..."